Okay, so welcome to calculus. Today's the 28th. And as promised, we're in section 8.3, which is called continuous money flow. Okay, so to make sense of this section, we need to recall two bits of information, something old and something new. So the thing that's old is this. So we have this thing, compound interest. So from either in the review at the beginning of this course, and hopefully, preferably, at some previous time in your experience, you learned two compound interest formulas. Okay, so the first one is the discrete version. So in this case, A is P multiplied by 1 plus R over N to NT. So this is when interest is compounded at discrete intervals, like monthly or daily or whatever. What was the other kind?
Continuous.
The continuous one, right? So then the continuous case analytically means you're letting the compounding frequency become infinite, so that the compounding formula no longer depends on n. The compounding formula is now A is P e to RT, where e is the natural number. So the compound interest in the continuous case, this formula is frequently called the PERT formula for obvious reasons. Okay, now, one thing about this is that the discrete case is far more realistic than the continuous case. That is to say, likely to be met in reality, right? I know of no financial institution that is compounding interest continuously. Right, but to an institution, they almost all compound monthly. So that means like this formula with n is 12. Okay? So this formula, the nearest approximation to using this formula in real life, this one, the discrete one, is called a certificate of deposit, which is where you can buy a CD at a bank, and they are basically saying, okay, if you give us $2,000 right now and you promise not to access it at all for a period of 5 years, then we'll give you such and such interest rate. So you're giving the bank a lump sum of money, and they have control over it for 5 years. And for the inconvenience to you, or for the convenience to them, of having control and your loss of control of that money, they pay you interest. Okay, so this is somewhat applicable in real life in the form of a CD. So one thing that both of these formulas lack, as far as realism is concerned, is that, in fact, this is not at all the way people use accounts frequently, right? You're all the time taking money out and putting money into an account. Okay, that's the way they actually work. So both of these formulas represent essentially a one-time event. And then you're monitoring in time what are the consequences of this one-time event? Okay, you purchase a CD, one-time event, and then over time, your balance increases. Okay, and you make no more withdrawals or deposits to that account. Okay, so today what we're going to do is we're going to say, well, what if you can make withdrawals and deposits all the time? We've got some no's, like, no, let's just forget that. Just forget it. We'll just assume the bank's doing it right. So we're going to do that. We're going to go through the case of, well, what if you can make withdrawals and deposits all the time? Okay. So in order to get there, we need to remember something else. About the usage of the phrase rate in a calculus course. So when you have a quantity that varies in time, the rate of that quantity is its time derivative. Okay, so then when you're, say, going on a road trip to Houston or wherever it is that you road trip to, when you're driving on the road, what is changing in time? Your position, right?
Distance.
Your position, yeah, or your distance from the start. So I'll say distance is good. So we have a special name for the rate of distance, the rate of change of distance. What do we call that? Not that one.
Speed.
Speed, right? Speed. So your speedometer is measuring, is reading out your rate of distance change. So for example, if you traveled at 50 miles an hour exactly, a constant 50 miles an hour for 7 hours in a straight line, then how far did you travel? 350 miles, right? So that's your rate multiplied by how long you were going that rate. Okay. Alternatively, what if you were making $40 an hour for 8 hours? Then how much money did you make? Yeah, 320, right? Just the product of these numbers. Okay. So generally speaking, what if it wasn't constant? Right? What if your speed on the highway was not constant? What if it was changing? Like you're slowly getting faster and faster. And you want to know, well, how far did you travel? How far did you travel? What is the general way, the calculus way, to find the total change if you have a rate which is not constant? Integral, right? If it's constant, then the total change is just the area of a rectangle, right? So did you notice that when we were traveling exactly 50 miles an hour in a straight line for exactly 7 hours, most of you said, well, then we traveled 350 miles. How did you get that? You multiplied it. Right? And what is the geometric interpretation of multiplication? Area of a rectangle, right? The reason why you travel 350 miles is because you've got a rectangle that's 50 miles per hour by 7 hours. So the total distance traveled is 350 miles. Okay? So if we had a rate that was non-constant, that means that we can't make a rectangle in a sense. So what we'll do is we'll cut it up into little rectangles, right? A few rectangles, and that'll be an approximation, right? Maybe we'll measure it every hour, or maybe we'll measure it every minute, or maybe we'll measure it every second. And the calculus point of view is, let's just do it just continuously. Let's have infinitely many little rectangles. And what's the name for when you do that? Integral. So rate is so the rate of something rate of a quantity is its doesn't have an apostrophe. I gotta think back to the rules of grade school, right? Is its time derivative. And to find the total change, in a quantity over an interval, you integrate the rate. Okay, so for example, suppose that we're traveling in a straight line. Okay, it has to be a straight line. We're traveling in a straight line. Rate f of t is, say, 10t miles per hour. And t is in hours. So what that means is that at time zero, how fast are we traveling?
Zero.
At time one, how fast are we traveling? 10. At time half an hour, how fast are we traveling? 5. Okay, so then we're sort of slowly increasing our speed. At 10 hours, we're finally going 100 miles an hour. Right? So then... find the total travel over the interval say 0 to 8. So how do you find the total amount that you traveled? So what will be the answer?
The integral from 0 to 8.
Yes, integral 0 to 8.
10t dt.
Okay. So then that's the meaning of this comment, right? To find the total change in a quantity, you integrate a rate. Okay, so then do we know, we want to use the fundamental theorem, right? So do we know an antiderivative of 10t?
Yes.
Yes, what is an antiderivative?
5t squared.
Very good, 5t squared.
Plus c.
Plus c. Right, and we'll drop the c. Right, since we're doing this. And then that would be 5 times 64, which is 320. Okay, so if this was our speed, then in 8 hours we would have traveled 320 miles. 320 miles. Okay, and just so that you have a connection to the geometry of it, what this is saying is that if this is f of t, and this is t, then what does 10t look like? What is y is 10t look like on this plot?
Straight line.
Straight line, right? Of slope 10. So if the scale of each axis was right, this would be 10t. And then we could mark out time 0 and time 8. And what does 320 have to do with my picture? It's the area of that region. So this is this. And the reason why this is the interpretation is that at the beginning, we're traveling slow, so the little rectangles that we're accumulating are little, right? We're not getting very far. And the further we go along, the faster we're going, so the faster we're accumulating rectangles, the faster we're accumulating miles. Good, so any question about this? Okay. So now what we're going to do is we're going to do this idea, except now we're going to be accumulating money, and we're going to start mixing in interest rates. We're going to start mixing in interest rates. And it's going to be a party, I promise. Okay. So the conceptual idea that we have here is we have a money flow, which can mean income or loss, right? Money is somehow coming to us or going from us. Okay, that's the rate of change in our account balance. Okay, so then conceptually, we're going to look at this. There's going to be two conceptual devices that we're going to use today. One of them is a hot dog stand, right? So then we're going to be just if you don't like hot dog stands, then just use any other business. Okay, but we're going to have a hot dog stand, and we're going to be continually taking in money. Okay. The other conceptual device is that we'll be talking about a lottery. Okay. So, you know, depending on your family members and other close friends, you know, maybe you've talked about the lottery. Some people in my family are interested in it. I'm not, because I'm a mathematician. Right. Okay.
Should that better your odds? No.
No, it doesn't. It doesn't. So there, in the lottery, there's this thing called the cash option. Okay. So what that means is that under normal circumstances, when you purchase a lottery ticket, if you don't check a certain box, then if you win the lottery, what you actually win is you win a monthly payment for a number of months, unless you die, and then the contract terminates, right? So, for example, if you win a $10 million lottery, then what you're really winning is something like an agreement that they'll pay you, I don't know, just making a number up, something like $20,000 a month for the next 200 months or something like that. Okay, that's what you're actually winning. Unless you check the cash option, in which case they'll give you one lump sum of money, and it's going to be less than $10 million. So if you win a $10 million lottery and you check the cash option, then they're going to give you like a lump sum payment of like $5.5 million. Okay, so that's the way it really works. So when you hear people playing Mega Ball or whatever the thingy is called, okay, where there's like half of the United States is involved.
Powerball,
thank you. Powerball, and you know, like last year someone got $1 billion payout, something that's just ridiculous. Was it $3 billion?
Three winners,
okay, three winners. Three people simultaneously got. So let's pretend for the sake of argument that it was just one person getting a $1 billion payout. Well, if they got a one, if they did that and they did not select the cash option, what that really means is they get paid, you know, like $100,000 a month for the next 300 months, 20 years or something like that. A lot of money by any standard. Okay, but if you selected the cash option, then you're not going to get $1 billion. You're going to get something like $500 million. You know, and you cry all the way to the bank, right, with your
with your
$500 million. Okay, it's less than $1 billion, right? It's less than
$1 billion. So you're saying if you take the payout option like over time, then you actually get the full amount?
No.
Yes. Because I don't think that's true.
So the answer is yes and no, and we're going to answer that right now.
Okay.
Taxes is a totally different matter. So
you have to pay to win, or you have to play to win, though.
Like,
you
know. Right.
You can't win.
Well, statistically, you can't win even if you do play, right? Statistically.
Well, somebody wins.
Right. Lottery is not a charity. Okay. So. Here's a question. Please compute the future value of $500 at, say, 3.5% continuous annual. So continuous annual interest rate. Continuous annual interest rate for, say, 8 years. So before we do this, this is an exercise you could have solved in your previous math course, at least in Calculus 1, right? We did this in the review, okay? So, or something just like it. So could someone take away this stilted math language and in plain language say what's being asked? Sorry? Right. So it's saying that in 8 years' time, if you had this kind of interest rate, what is $500 in 8 years' time? That's what's being asked. If you put $500 into a continuous 3.5 annual interest rate account for 8 years, what will the account balance be at the end of time? So the formula is A is PE to RT. So A. Do we know this, or are we going to find this? We're going to find this. P, do we know this, or are we going to find this?
We know it.
It's 500. Do we know E?
Yes.
Yes, right, it's the natural number. Okay, just making sure. Okay, how about R? Yes, 0.035. And then do we know T? Yes, right, so then it's 8. So notice that the way the formula is, we know everything on the right-hand side, okay? The thing that we want is by itself on the left-hand side. So plugging this all into the machine, as a consequence of that consideration, we get, 500 times exponential 0.035 times 8. So I get 661.56 rounded to the nearest cent. So I'm gonna write this real quick. What if I write 61.56 to the nearest cent? Maybe I misread my calculator, right? It says 661, but somehow I wrote 61.
Well, you can realize that that number was smaller than your original number, so that wasn't correct.
Right. So does everyone see that this really doesn't make sense? What's presently written does not make any sense. Okay, because what it would be saying is that as a result of putting $500 into our interest-bearing account for 8 years, at the end of that time, our account balance is.
I got something else on my calculator.
Good.
Oh.
So.
I got like 4,000.
Okay. Well, that's an error.
Okay.
That's an error. So then, now what the calculator actually says is this: 661. So now that I've put that red 6 that was not there, is this reasonable? Does this seem like a reasonable number? Yeah. Okay. $500 now, in 8 years at that interest rate, is about $661. Yeah. Okay. All right. Of course, in one sense, this is totally unreasonable because there is no financial institution offering a continuous interest rate. Okay. Good. So now, how about this exercise? Find the present value of, say, $800. At, say, 3 years in the future, at, how about 4.2% continuous annual interest rate. Annual interest rate. Okay, so now there's math language in here. Could someone please subtract the stilted math language and say in plain language what it is that's being asked? Right. So you can kind of think of it like planning. I want to have $800 in my account in 3 years. How much money needs to be in there exactly now? Okay, which is why it's called a present value. So when you're dealing with present values, it's still this formula. It's still this formula. However, which is the one that's known and what's unknown? Right. P is the one that is unknown. Right? Formerly, R and T are both known, and formerly this was unknown and known. Now the roles are reversed. As a result, usually when you're dealing with present values, you solve for P. So if we solve for P, then this would be A over E to RT is P. But then instead of writing this as a quotient, we can write it as a product by moving the E to RT up into the numerator. But what's the cost of moving a factor into the numerator? You negate the exponent. So this would be e to negative rt is p. So this formula right here, just reversing it, is also the PERT formula. So this is also the PERT formula. It's exactly. It doesn't matter. But this one is more common to write it this way. So notice now that in this exercise, the current exercise, we now have everything that's on the right-hand side, and what we want is the left-hand side. So we can just plug in the things into this. So let's plug that into the machine. So that'd be 800 exponential negative 0.042 times 3. So 705.29. So in the same sense, so I asked if this number was reasonable on the previous exercise. So I ask in the same sense, is this number reasonable for this exercise? Yeah, it is, right? Because we're saying, our conclusion is saying that $705 now is $800 in the future. It remaining in an interest-bearing account. Okay? Any question about this? Concept of present and future values. Okay. So, now let's mix in some calculus. So I'm going to read a story out loud, and then I'll write the important things down. Okay. So the book says soda machine, but I'm going to stick with hot dog. The income from our hot dog stand in dollars per year is growing exponentially, which means that we make some amount of money this year, and we make even more money next year, and we make even more money the next year, etc. So it's growing exponentially. When we first opened our hot dog stand, it was producing income at a rate of $500 per year. By the end of the first year, it was producing an income at a rate of $510.10 per year. Find the total income produced by our hot dog vending thing at the end of 3 years. Okay. So the income is growing exponentially. That's telling us that our income takes the following form. It must be some initial amount times an exponential term. So the next statement is that the initial income was at a rate of 500 per year. So that's a sentence, right? But what does that have to do, you know, an English sentence, but what does that have to do with mathematics? What is 500? P is 500? Okay. So I agree that that's correct, but there's even an intermediate step that I want you to see. What does it mean? I do agree that eventually it's going to mean P is 500, but even before that, what does it mean about our F? F, what is zero?
T.
F of zero is what? 500. So now we know two things about f. It's this, right? F of t must be this. And furthermore, we know that when you evaluate at 0, you're supposed to get 500. So now let's evaluate this at t is 0. So 500 is p exponential k times 0. Well, k times 0 is 0, so this is e to 0. So what is e to 0?
1.
So 500 is p, as she said initially. Okay, so then as a result, we know that f of t is 500 e to kt. So in the end, the meaning of this second sentence is it tells us, well, the first sentence told us that our income must take this form. And the second sentence told us that p is 500. But we have yet to figure out what? Well, t is the time variable. Right. K is what we don't know. Okay, so here's the next sentence in the story. By the end of the first year, the income is at a rate of 510.10 per year. So that's another English sentence, but what does that have to do with mathematics?
So f at 1 equals 510.10?
Yes. So that's telling us that f at 1 is 510.10. But we also know that this is f. So then we can plug in 1 into this, and we should be able to solve for k. So 510.10 is 500 e to k, because we plugged in t as 1. So what we want to do is we want to solve for k. So how do we solve for k? So what's the first thing?
Divide by
500. So if I type that into the machine there, so 510.10 over 500, that's 1.0202. Okay, now what? What is it? Natural log, right? Natural log of 1.0202 is k. So as a result, we now know the income function. Okay. So the income function is f of t is 500 exponential of log of (1.0202) t. Okay. Now the last sentence is find the total income over the first 3 years. Okay. So what do we have to do to answer this question?
Integral.
Integral, right? Integral. So specifically, it will be integral, and what will be the limits?
0 to 3.
And then what are we integrating?
500 e to the actual.
Yes, this thing here. 500 e, crazy number. dt. So now, that's kind of a crazy looking number. But in the end, it's just a constant, right? And this 500 is just another constant. It could be factored out. So is that we want to use the fundamental theorem. Is this one of the antiderivatives we know? Yes, right? So if I was asking you, what's the antiderivative of e to ax dx, then what is the antiderivative?
E to ax
divided by a. So we just have this crazy looking number here. So this would be 500, and then e to log 1.0202 t divided by log 1.0202, and then evaluate from 0 to 3. And what I used here was that antiderivative e to ax dx is e to ax divided by a plus a constant. Okay, and then now, see if you can get your calculator to give you an answer for this. I'll give you a second to do that. Personally, I would recommend writing it like this. So 500 over log 1.0202, factoring that out. And then this would be e to log 1.0202 times 3, and then minus 1. Right, that's easy because you plug in 0. So what do you get if you do all that? Any idea? Any? That's it. Okay, So you say it doesn't look right. Now, I want to ask you to consider the following. So it was 500 a year.
Over 3 years. Yes, then it looks right.
Okay, right. So the income was 500 a year. So at time zero, the rate was 500 per year. Okay, what was it at time one?
510.
At time two, what was it? Right, we didn't do it, but I could do it right here real quick. So log of 1.0202 times 2, so 520. And at the end of 3 years, the rate was that number, 530. So it's always close to $500, right, per year. So is it reasonable that we made $1,500 over the course of 3 years? Yeah, that seems reasonable to me. If it said 15,000, that wouldn't be reasonable. In a sense, what I'm saying is that this would be more than wrong. Okay? It'd be wrong in sort of a categorical fashion. Right? It's wrong in the way that you might say, oh, I make $1,000 a week, so at the end of the year, I expect to make $1 million. No, that's not going to work, right? Okay. Good. So any question about this exercise? Okay. Now what we're going to say is we're going to say, okay, suppose that we had our hot dog stand and we just considered it and we said that the total income will be $1,545. Okay. Now the question is how much money would we have to put in a bank account so that instead of let's just forget the hot dog thing and let's just take that amount of money and put it in a bank account so that at the end of the time we'll have $1,545.91. Okay? So that is the present value of a money flow. So we answered an exercise. We did a present value exercise on this page, but it was the present value of a one-time of a one-time thing. Right? We want $800 in the future. So right now what we want to know is what is the present value of a money flow? Conceptually speaking, you might think of this as saying, I would trade $705 right now for $800 in the future. Okay, so now it's saying, well, the question is what would we trade our hot dog stand for? Okay, the hot dog stand represents an income. So what would we trade our hot dog stand for? Okay. So this is the present value.
Is this like the valuation of the business? Is that what we're doing?
Yes.
Interesting.
Yes, we're getting into the idea of putting a value on a business, of putting a value on an income. But you must also understand that this is entirely contrived because because everything that we're doing is assuming a continuous interest rate. And there's no such thing. Okay, so the way that you actually do this in real life is you have to do formulas that are a little more complicated than these that reflect the fact that interest is not compounded continuously. It's compounded at usually monthly or something. So the present value of a money flow. So suppose we're given a money flow f of t. Now I'm going to plot f of t. So here's t. And this is time 0, and this is time big T. Okay. Yeah. This is the 28th time I've drawn this function in the course. Okay, so what does, if this is the money flow, F, right, you might think that this is like the income that we get from our hot dog stand. And maybe this is over the course of a year, right? So then more sales in the summer, less sales in the winter, or whatever, I don't know. So what does the area under this curve represent? Right, the total income, the total money flow. If we wanted to find the total money flow that we get from our hot dog stand, we could integrate this F, zero to big T. That conceptually, that would be like saying, okay, every time we take a dollar from someone, we just take that dollar and we just put it in a pile. Okay, which is not very wise, right, in money sense, but you're just putting it in a pile. Okay, now the thing is that this amount of money that we get right here, right, we get this amount of money, this little chunk of money at this time, and this other little chunk of money at some other time, and this little chunk of money at some other time. So we want to know that how much is all of this worth just at time zero? But now we have to account for the fact that that we're receiving money all during this interval instead of just at a certain time. Okay, so the way that we're going to have to deal with this is we're going to approximate. We're going to make an approximation of the present value. And the way we're going to do it is we're going to cut this into rectangles. It had really just been too long since we had considered rectangles.
20 minutes.
Right, 20 minutes. Yeah, it's just calculus class, you know. It's brace yourself. Rectangles are coming. Okay, so to make an estimate, what we'll do is we'll make this partition. 0 is little t0 less than t1 less than dot 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 less than tn, which is big T. So what I'm saying is that, you know, one of these here is TI. So that's the ith fence post. And we have made this uniform, which means all of these have the same width. Okay, so then remembering back to the way we wrote things the previous time we did that, what do you suppose I'm going to call this common width?
Delta X.
Not delta X, but delta T, right? Delta T. So each one of these has size delta T. And so what I want you to observe is that for each one of these rectangles, right, you know, maybe this represents a day. Then we get this money on this day, right? And we get that money on that day. Or maybe this is a time span of a couple years, and maybe this represents 1 hour. Well, we get this money at this hour and that money at that hour. Okay, so that when we get the money depends on what money we're talking about. Okay. So what we're going to do is we're going to approximate each one of these bits of money with the rectangle. And what we're going to do is we're always going to select for each region, we're going to select the height of the right fence post to make a rectangle. So here's the height of the rectangle, so we're not really including that bit. Okay, here's the height of the next rectangle. Here's the height of the next rectangle. So this one's an overestimate. That's an overestimate. So we're always using the height that is on the right. So the ith rectangle So that's to say this one. We want to find its area. What is the area of the ith rectangle? Well, generally speaking, what's the formula for the area of a rectangle?
Base times height.
Base times height. So what is the base of all the rectangles?
Delta T.
Delta T. And then what is going to be the height of this rectangle? No, but that's close. That's also close, but not right. There is no delta T I. But now you're, that's the closest one, but not right. F of what? T I. Okay, so that's what I mean, is this is T I, right? It's always going to be on the right side. So this height is f of ti. So f of ti times delta t. So the area is f of ti times delta t. And the thing is, this is how much money. The way we're approximating this, this is the quantity of money, amount of money, / income, at time is ti. So we need to know what is the present value. Right, what is the value of this money that we got at time ti at time back at time zero? So how much is this worth at this time back here? Right. So what this is. So what we really have is that ai is f of ti delta t. But we have a formula that relates the present value to A, right? So what is the present value formula?
Is it A equals P?
No. It's the PERT formula, except it needs to be the other way around. Yeah, that one. And remember that P is A e to negative RT. Okay, so that means that the ith accumulated value is this much, which means the ith present value is pi is ai e to negative rti. So what I'm saying is that this area, we're calling this area ai. You know, you might think, oh, that's how much money I got on a Sunday. Okay, but how much would that have been worth if I would have got it, if I would have had it 2 weeks ago or 2 years ago or whatever? So that means that the formula for the present value is f of ti delta t e to negative rti. So that's the present value of the ith slice, of the ith slice. So how do we find the total present value? By adding these up, right? By summation. So P is the sum of all of these slices. Okay, but we can now substitute that in. So P is the sum from I is 1 to N of f of ti delta t e to negative r ti. And what this is the present value. This is the approximation of our present value when we approximate it within rectangles. So in real life, okay, the way that this is done is that you choose a value of n that is, well, first off, you don't use the continuous interest formula. You use whatever interest formula is actually at play. And then you just use as many rectangles as is necessary to get you an accurate approximation, like every day maybe is good for your business, or maybe every month is good for your business. Okay, but this is not real life. This is a calculus course, right? So, which is just an approximation of real life, I suppose. So the calculus mantra is that, well, if 8 rectangles isn't good enough, then how about 8 million? And in fact, let's do the calculus thing and say what? Infinitely many rectangles. Okay, so the calculus point of view is that we let the number of rectangles become infinite, and then we have this formula that P is the limit as n goes to infinity of the sum from I is 1 to n of f of ti delta t e to negative r ti. And then we get to make, again, right, the longest standing joke in calculus, which is what?
Something about Greek.
Yeah, you compute the limit of this expression, which uses Greek letters, and all the Greek letters become Latin letters. It's so funny. It's funny every time. So this is now integral from 0 to big T, f of t e to negative rt dt. Okay, and this is called the present value of a money flow. Okay, and it is a formula that you need to memorize. Just like the previous times we went over this construction where we cut something into rectangles, you don't need to memorize the construction, but you do need to memorize this formula. Okay, so any question about this? So what this is saying, the conceptual meaning of this formula is saying the following. On the previous exercise, we said that our hot dog stand is going to make $1,545.91. Okay? So that would mean that over 3 years it's going to do that. That would mean that right now we'd be willing to take more or less or the same to give it up for 3 years.
More.
Right, we'd be willing to take less. Right, so it's just like the cash option, right, in the lottery.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
Right, so if the hot dog stand makes $1,545.91 over 3 years, then right now we'd probably be willing to give it up for maybe $1,100 or something. Yeah, give me $1,100 now, and you do the hot dog stand, and I'll take the $1,100. Okay, so now let's do an exercise. Okay. So suppose that we really went to, you know, serious distribution, I guess. And we're expecting the hot dog income to be f of t is 75,000 t for the next 3 years. So what that's saying is that our income rate at year one should be 75,000. What would our income rate be at year two? 150,000. And our income rate at year three, whatever three times 70, whatever that is, right? You know what? Mathematicians are notoriously bad at arithmetic, to be honest with you. Mathematicians are only interested to know that it can be done, right? There's so many jokes about that. I won't. Okay, I won't do it. I almost did, but I won't. Okay.
Well, we haven't had a joke for the day.
We haven't had a joke?
We haven't.
Okay, here's the shortest one that I know. Here's a typical joke about mathematicians where they're the butt of the joke. So someone. No, here we go. It's not someone. A physicist. A physicist is in a hot air balloon. And, you know, being a physicist, they didn't read any of the instructions because they thought they knew everything that there was to know about everything, including hot air balloons. Okay, I don't think that about physicists, but that's the way the joke goes, right? So the physicist gets in the hot air balloon, and immediately the physicist is lost. Okay, he has no idea where they are because they didn't pay attention to the weather or anything like that. So the physicist is just floating out in the middle of nowhere, and they're just a few hundred feet off the ground, and they see someone and say, "Hey, can you tell me where I am?" And the person thinks about it visibly for a while and then responds, "You're in a hot air balloon." And the physicist says, "Oh, just my luck. I would run across a mathematician." because they gave me an answer that's exactly right and totally useless. Okay. Okay. So here's the first question. Find the total income over these 3 years. So what's being asked? Am I asking you to find to use the formula we just did?
No.
No, right? I'm not asking that. So what's the so how do we find the total income? Okay. So I heard an answer. Someone said this number times three. Okay. So let's write that down and let's look at that. So that number would be, you know, whatever it is. So 75,000 times 3, is that right?
No.
No, that's not right. It's not right. Because that would be the case if the hot dog stand made a constant income of 75,000 per year. Okay? So then 75,000 the first year, 75,000 the second, 75,000 the third. That's not what it says. It says that you make the rate, the income rate, is 75,000 T, where T is the number of years, which means that the rate at time zero is zero. So you just open the hot dog stand, you're not making any money. No one knows where you are. Okay, and then the longer you're open, I suppose, the more people know where you are, you make more money, more and more money. So it's not this. So how do we answer the question?
The integral.
Integral, right? So integral 0 to 3 of 75,000 t dt. And not to harp on that previous answer too much, but the previous answer would be the answer if this t wasn't there. If that t wasn't there. But the fact that that t is there means that it's going to integrate to t squared over 2. Okay. So this would be 37,500 t squared evaluated from 0 to 3. And then what is that?
337,500.
What is it? 337,500? Okay, that sounds good. So this would mean that if we operated the if this was our rate, our income rate for 3 years, and we operated the hot dog stand for those 3 years, and we just took all the money and put it in a big pile. Just immediately, just everything was into the pile. That would mean that at the end of 3 years, 337,000 whatever, this much money. Okay, now the question we want to ask is that what would we give up, right? How much money would it take for us to agree, okay, you do the hot dog stand, and I'll take the lump sum of money. Okay, is that going to be more or less than this?
Less,
right? Because I'm willing to take less now. You know, maybe it's something like $250,000. I'll take $250,000 now, and you do the hot dog stand. Okay, so let's see how much that is. So the technical name for that concept is the present value of a money flow. So the formula, just copying it from the previous page, is integral 0 to big T, f of t. Oh, I need to tell you stuff. Well, okay, e to negative rt. I'll finish copying the formula, dt. So what you need to know is that what is the present value if the interest rate is 8% continuous annual? Okay, so 8% continuous annual interest rate. So that would mean that we need to evaluate integral where to where?
0 to
3. 0 to 3. And then 75,000 t, and then e to what?
0
to 8. Almost. Negative, right?
Oh, yeah, negative.
Negative 0.08 t dt. Okay, so is there any question why, in the end, this is what's being asked? Okay, so here we have an integral. Now, these constants, all that they serve is just, conceptually, they don't really do anything, right? They're just sort of hanging out. So if we just cover them up, right, then the antiderivative that we want to do essentially looks like t e to t. And then there's constants hanging around. So it's like t e to t. Is that one of the antiderivatives that we know? It's not, right? We know how to antidifferentiate t. We know how to antidifferentiate e to t. But we don't know how to antidifferentiate their product. At least we don't have a formula for it. Okay, so then what's the next step in the Riesz procedure? Even there's something before
algebraic.
That. Is there something algebraic you can do?
No.
No, there's not. What's the next step?
A U
substitution. Can we do a substitution?
No.
Which means what?
We have to do by parts.
We have to do by parts. And I'd like to point out how that's not really that surprising that we're going to have to do by parts, because look at the formula. It's the integral of a product.
Right?
Okay. The only way that you're going to get around using by parts is if f of t is really nice. And you can see that's already pretty nice, but it wasn't nice enough to not have to do by parts. Okay? So any question about why this question is saying this integral, and then why this integral requires by parts? Okay. So that means we need to, if we're committed to doing by parts, then what do I need to do?
Find u.
So we're going to have to lay an egg. Okay, so then what is this thing? Algebraic. Right?
Can you factor out the 75,000?
You can, but it's not going to help.
No.
You can, but...
Okay. One of those preference things?
Yeah, it's a preference thing. It doesn't... Your answer will be right no matter... Either way.
Okay.
So how about this?
E.
Okay, so which comes first, A or E?
A.
So what does that tell us then? Good. So U is?
75,000.
Yeah, 75,000 T. And then what is DV?
Everything.
Everything else. So DV is E to negative 0.08. T dt. So how many quantities are there in the biparts formula? Four. How many of them do we presently have?
Two.
Which one can be determined from u?
D.
Du. So du is 75,000 dt. Which one can be determined from v? From dv. V can. How do we get V from dv?
The integral.
Antiderivative.
Yeah.
So do we know the antiderivative of e to negative 0.08 t dt? We do. Right? It's e to negative 0.08 t divided by negative 0.08. Okay. Then the right-hand side of the biparts formula is uv minus antiderivative v du. But there's something not right about what I have written.
You need to have limits.
I need to have limits, right? Because we're computing an integral, not an antiderivative. So that means 0 to 3. So, this would be 75,000 t multiplied by e to negative 0.08 t divided by negative 0.08, and then this evaluated from 0 to 3, and then minus integral 0 to 3. E to negative 0.08 t divided by negative 0.08, 75,000 dt. Okay, any question getting to this position? Okay. The numbers never work out nice in this section because we have these, you know, money, right? Interest rate, 8%, $45. Nothing works. None of the numbers work out nicely. Okay. So we can evaluate this. This isn't too bad. Why is this part not too bad? Well, so ignoring this for a minute, why is this not too bad? Yeah, because one of them is zero, and when you plug in zero there, it's just all zero, right? So that's not too bad, that's nice. So we'll plug in 3, that'd be 75,000 multiplied by 3, and then e to negative 0.08, and then that multiplied by 3, divided by negative 0.08. So I'll do that in a second. And then this negative and that negative cancel, so it becomes plus integral 0 to 3. And then I'll combine this number and that number. So 75,000 divided by 0.08. That's 937,500. And then e to negative 0.08 t dt. So is this one of the, for the fundamental theorem, is this one of the antiderivatives that we know?
Yes.
Yes?
How
is that tedious? It is tedious. But at any rate, it just is what it is. Okay, so then 7,500, or 1,000, or whatever this is, 3 times exponential negative divided by. So this first number is negative 221. 221. And then 2390.859. Okay, then plus 937,500 e to negative 0.08 t divided by negative 0.08, and then this from 0 to 3. Okay, this is less nice because now when we plug in 0, we still get something, right? So this would be this number, so negative 2212390.859. I'll divide this into that and spend the negative to switch the order. So this number, 937,500. Okay. Plus 117,187,050. And then E to negative 0.08 from 3 to 0. Okay, now that's probably enough where I can put it into my calculator successfully. And this should be a T here. So this T, this red T I'm writing, I had previously omitted it. Okay, so then the number I'm getting is 288,063.8941. Okay. So now, is this number even close to reasonable? Well, let's think about it. What did this number represent?
Well,
How much we would take to give up the hot dog stand?
Yeah, so we're operating the hot dog stand, okay, for 3 years. And in part one, we said that over the course of 3 years, we expect our income to be $337,000. And so that's the meaning of that number. What would someone in plain language please tell us what the meaning of this number is supposed to be?
That's how much you would have after 3 years in continuously giving
yourself? No.
That's what we would take today.
That's what we'd take today, right? This is the cash option, right? Forget the hot dog stand, right? Forget the lottery, right? Forget the monthly payments. This is how much I would take right now. Okay, so is, in that sense, is this a reasonable number compared to that one? Yeah, it seems reasonable, right? This is saying $337,000 is what we expect. So right now I'd take 288. Give me 288 right now, and you do the hot dog stand. Okay.
So where's the 8% come from in that situation?
The 8% is that the reason why I would consider this reasonable is because I would take your 288 lump sum and I would immediately deposit it into an account. That's 8%.
And in 3 years you'd have.
And in 3 years, this is how much money I would have.
So the 8% is just an arbitrary number that was made up.
Yes, right. If it comes with the problem.
So yes.
Right.
That's what he wanted the return. He wants an 8% return over 3 years.
Well, it's like saying that your income could be $337,000, but you also have access to an 8% account. So for that reason, you'd be willing to take this instead, right now, if you could have it right now.
Instead of waiting the 3 years to get
it. Yeah, instead of operating the hot dog stand. Okay, but now there's something notable. There's something notable about this, and it's a gap that we need to fill now. So this one, this total income, this is like saying, okay, we're going to operate the hot dog stand. And every time we get money, we're just going to put it into a pile. Just put it in a big pile, and we're just, look at this beautiful pile of $337,000 that we've accumulated. If there's really better strategy than that you can do. What's a better strategy? Invest, right? So instead of just taking that money and putting it in a pile, let's take that money, and every time we get money, let's put it in a bank account. Right? So then you'd get even more money if you did that. Right? This money represents, you know, mattress R us, right? You take all of your money and you put it under the mattress. And this person is saying that, well, I have an 8% account and I'd take this money right now. Okay. Now let's fill in the last gap and say, well, what if you're going to operate the hot dog stand and also you're going to take all of your money and put it in an account? Okay? The name for this concept is called the accumulated amount. Of a money flow. So the accumulated amount of a money flow is given as follows. So remember that the discrete case back in the day when things were simpler, we said that this was the formula, the PERT formula. when things were simpler, right? When it was just one payment, just the one time. This also is the PERT formula, but just with the terms rearranged. It's the same formula. And then we said, well, what if instead of a one-time payment, if instead of a one-time payment, we have this money flow concept? And then we said, oh, okay, to do that requires an integral. So this is the discrete case. The continuous case is we said, okay, the continuous case for the PERT formula, for P, can be understood in this way. It is the integral from 0 to big T of f of little t e to negative rt dt. And now what we want is a formula for A. What we want is a formula for A. And it comes just like this one. It'll be P e to rt, except now we have to use this for P. And now instead of little t, we use big T. So it'll be e to r big T, and then integral 0 to big T, f of little t e to negative r little t d little t. So this again is the PERT formula. It again is the PERT formula because this, what is this thing right here? That's P, isn't it? PERT, right? PERT, right? Like that. Okay, so this formula is called the accumulated amount. Of a money flow. And it is yet another formula from today that you must memorize. And I'd like for you to observe that this right here, this is the present value of a money flow. So once you have the present value of a money flow, the accumulated value can be obtained just by multiplying it by something. So it's quite easy once you have done this, right? Once you've done the integral part, then you just multiply it by something. So as a consequence, what this means is that these three things, the total value of a money flow, the present value of a money flow, and the accumulated value of a money flow, they are always asked, all three of them, on every exercise, essentially. Because one of them is fairly easy to do, one of them is somewhat difficult to do, and then the last one is free, essentially. So, that being the case, let's go back to the previous exercise, this hot dog thingy that we were talking about. So, same exact story. So, this is the previous exercise, continued. Now, part three. Find the accumulated amount of money flow. So the formula here is A is E to R big T, integral 0 to big T, f of little t e negative r little t d little t. So this formula looks sort of daunting, but it's really actually not a big deal. Why is it really actually not a big deal? Yeah, we already did this, right? That's 288,000 whatever from the previous exercise. So all that really you must do is evaluate this and then multiply it. So A is E to 0.08. Multiply, what was T?
It was 3.
3. And then the value from the previous exercise was 288,063. 0.8941. Right, but we don't round until the last.
Oh, until the last bit.
Right. Okay, so if we do that, okay, so then my calculator is telling me 366,200.9806. So, would someone explain to me, so part one said that the total money flow is $337,000. Part three is saying that the accumulated amount of money is even bigger, 366,000. Why is that even more? How are those two situations conceptually different? Right. Whereas the first one, you can imagine that it's somehow like set up on direct deposit or something like that. The first situation is it's direct deposit into a 0% account. Okay. This situation is that all of the money that you get is direct deposit into an 8% interest account, and interest is being reckoned continuously. So the instant money gets put in is the instant it starts accumulating value. Which is not the way bank accounts are, by the way, right? Bank accounts usually have the fine print usually says something like, well, what we'll do is we'll take the record of your deposits and withdrawals, and we'll compute the average balance of your account for the month, and then we'll reckon our percentage over the average, right? Using the average amount. So this is instantaneous. Right? You put a penny in, immediately it starts accumulating value. Not a lot, but some value. Right? Okay, good. Any question about this? This one. Okay, let's do another. Okay. So how about we have a money flow of constant 2,000 per year. For 5 years. Okay. So, first question is, what is the total money flow? 10,000, right? It's 10,000. So, strictly speaking, if it was a little more complicated, right? If the exercise was a little more complicated, you'd have to do an integral. And so let's go ahead and write down what that integral would be, right? It would be the integral from 0 to 5 of 2,000 dt, which is of course 2,000 t from 0 to 5, which is of course 10,000. That's a little bit, using an integral to find the area of a rectangle is a little overkill, right? We use rectangles to define integrals. Yeah, but if the function was more complicated, you would need an integral. Okay, so what's the next thing that's always asked in such a question? The present value. So the present value of the money flow. Present value of the money flow is this formula. So 0 to big T. So P is 0 to big T. F of little t e to negative r little t d little t. So that's the formula. And now, I hope that you recall that on the last exercise that we worked, we needed to use integration by parts. Okay, so on this particular exercise, what are the limits of integration?
0 to 5.
And then 2,000. Yeah, I gotta give you something.
Uh-huh.
I've gotta give you, 6% continuously annually. Continuous annual. This is coming from page, well, my inspiration from it is coming from page 445, but I'm kind of changing up the details here a little bit. So this will be what? Negative 0.06 t dt. Okay, so at the analogous position on the previous exercise, we used by parts. We don't need to on this one. Why not?
Because it's just constant.
Right, because the rate function f turned out to be just a constant. So that's nice. Okay, so then we can do this pretty rapidly. So that'd be 2,000 e to negative 0.06 t divided by negative 0.06, and then from 0 to 5. 2,000 divided by 0.06 is a bunch of threes. So 3, 3, 3, 3, 3 point infinitely many threes. And then,
are you going to flip it around? Is that how you're going to get rid of that image?
Yes. And then from 5 to 0. So I, as she said, I switched the order of evaluation so that I could be rid of the negative. So then 3, 3, 3, 3, 3 point 3. And then this would be 1 minus e to negative 0.3. Okay, so that's as simple as I can get before I type it into the machine. Okay, so then Because, do you agree with this position?
Yes.
If you plug in zero, if you plug in zero into this, what do you get?
Oh, one.
One.
Yes, you're
correct. So I'm going to write something down here. So 1,8639.39. 2,644. So what do you think about this number I have written down? So first off, it's too big. Why do you think it's too big?
Because it needs to be less than 10,000.
That's got to be less than 10,000, right? We're saying that we have this money flow of 2,000 per year. In 5 years, we expect the total flow to be $10,000. The present value must be less than that. The present value essentially represents what would you be willing to take right now to give up that money flow, to give up that income source. So in a sense, yeah, I'll take 18, yeah. Give it to me, right? But no, this is not numerically reasonable. So does everyone see that your answer to this exercise needs to be less than this one? Okay. So all I did was I just put a 1 in front of it. And that number is the right number. Okay, so 8,000. Does that seem reasonable?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that seems reasonable. That for a not too unreasonable interest rate, I'd be willing to take 8,600 right now instead of working for 5 years and getting 10,000. Okay. So then, what is the last thing that's always asked? Right, the accumulated amount of a money flow. So then in this case, the formula is E to R big T, and then integral 0 to big T, F of little t, E to negative R little t d little t. And that looks terrible, except for the fact that we already did the hard part. So the answer is going to be E 0.06 times 5. And then this number. Okay, now before I write anything down, as far as these two previous numbers, right, we've got 10,000 and 8,600. Are we expecting this one to be smaller, in between, bigger?
Bigger.
Right. The biggest one of them all. So the number that my calculator is telling me is 11,661.96025. Okay, so again, not to be redundant, but I'll just do it anyway, is that total money flow, what that represents, that's like saying, okay, we're going to run the hot dog stand, and we're just going to take every bit of money, and we're going to put it in a pile. Okay. If we do that, then we will get $10,000 in the pile. Okay. So this strategy represents that, okay, since all I'm going to do with my money is just put it in a big pile, but I do have this bank account that I could buy a CD at or something like that, then I'd be willing to accept $8,639.39 right now. And I'd go straight over to the bank and put it in the account. And I know that at the end of 5 years, I'd have $10,000. So you work the hot dog stand. Right, you do it. And I'll take the $8,600 right now.
Basically, you're selling the business, right?
Yeah. You're selling, basically, you operate and take all the risk and all the reward of the business. Right. And this one represents it saying that, well, I want to operate the hot dog stand, and I'm not going to just put my money in a pile because I have access to a bank account or whatever, an investment account. And instead of putting my money in a pile, I'm going to always put it into that account. So that's why this one is always going to be the best of all options, assuming everything is positive, right? Assuming that you're always making money, assuming that your interest rate is always positive, etc. So this one will always be the best. Good. Yeah, well, you see the one is bigger. No, so the interval over which this is occurring is 0 to big T. Okay, is 0 to big T. Little t is just I don't know if it's a technical term, but it's called a dummy variable or an index variable. So what I'd like for you to observe is that I'll rewrite this formula. So this is e to r big T integral 0 to big T. And now maybe you like some other letter. So what's your favorite letter that's not currently in use? Z. So this would be f of z e to negative r z dz. This formula, this graphite formula, and this red formula are the same. Why are they the same formula? That's the interval in which this hot dog process is occurring. Little t just or z just represents a number between 0 and big T.
So it just happens to be
right, the minuscule version of this letter, yeah. But so have a look at this red expression that you can see right here. When you evaluate it, will the end result depend on z? So when you finally evaluate all of it, will there be any z's left?
No,
there won't be any z's left. Similarly, if you look at this graphite formula that's right there, right above my thumbs, when you evaluate that formula, will there be any little t's left? Now, there won't be any little t's. And that's the reason why these two formulas are the same. You could use any letter for little t at all, because little t has no intrinsic meaning. It's just a value between 0 and big T. Big T is this. Other questions? I don't know what you mean.
stem from like calculus or, not calculus, stem from like chemistry or physics or something else? Because you, like, so you can't have something continuously compounded, and in a business, you can't take all of your money that you're making and put it into another account because you have expenses.
So, I'll try and answer your question like this. So, in real life situations, interest is reckoned discreetly, right? Every month or whatever. So, we could come up with formulas that are just like that. And in the end, what would happen is that we'd come back to this construction. I gotta keep these in order, otherwise it'll be all messed up. When we get to this construction, so this is from a few minutes ago. Instead of letting n go to infinity, we would have kept it here, like this, as a summation, a discrete summation. And instead of using a continuous compounding formula, we would have used the discrete compounding formula, 1 plus r over n to nt. And as a result, it would not be an integral, and there would be several more formulas, or several more, there'd be at least one more variable, because you'd have n, okay? So it would just be more complicated, and it wouldn't be a calculus course, because the integral only shows up when you compute limit. Right? So the answer to the question is, you might be saying, why are we doing this? So we're doing this because this is a calculus course. In the end, is the answer. Yeah, it's a way to force the situation. It's a way to take a situation that's somewhat reasonable, like okay, money and things like this, and then we're forcing it into the integral formalism. So it doesn't really work that way, but if we were to keep it in the summation form like this, then you wouldn't be able to answer any questions, at least not by hand. You could do it with a spreadsheet. Machines are quite good at that. But then it wouldn't be a calculus course anymore. Does that answer it? Yeah, so that's why. Computing the limit of the sum is what forces it to become a calculus question. But if you understand these ideas, then it's really not too much of a stretch to start doing the exact same thing discretely with Excel. And you could evaluate a business in the same way. We have time for one more. Let's do a good one.
Yes, a good one.
Let's do one that requires integration by parts twice.
Let's not, please.
No, let's not do that. Let's not do that. Okay, how about this one? So suppose we have a money flow. F of t is, let's just make it up, 500 e to 0.04 t. So you have a money flow. Oh, it's not so different than the very first example, right? So you have a money flow that starts out at 500, but it slowly gets bigger. And it gets a little bigger all the time. Okay, and we want so money flow, and we have a 0. Or no, we have an 8% continuous continuous annual interest rate for 10 years. Okay, let's find all three things. The total flow, the present value of the money flow, and the accumulated amount of the money flow. So using F and big T and all that, what's the formula for the total flow?
Integral from 0 to 10.
Okay, integral 0 to 10 of what?
500
E. Okay, wait. So I said big T's and stuff, right? So
Sorry.
What you're saying is correct. Right, because I just want to copy down. One of the strategies in teaching is to say the same thing as many times
Absolutely.
As possible. So I'm just taking this opportunity to rewrite the formula one more time. And yes, as you were saying, yes, 0 to 10, and then this thing, 500 E to 0.04 T dt. Okay, then is this one of the antiderivatives we know?
Yes.
Yes, terrific. Okay, so it'd be 500 E to 0.04 divided by 0.04 T there, and then 0 to 10. So 500 divided by 0.04 is 12500, and then like so. Okay, so then plugging this into the machine, I get a syntax error because I left out a parentheses. Okay, so I get 6147.81. Do we have agreement?
I'm sure.
I got a couple of nods. So let's see if this is even close to reasonable. Right. So then, At the very first instant, the income is 500 per year, right? The very first instant is 500 per year. And then how many years did we do this for? For 10 years, right? And if it was 500 per year the whole time, then what would the total flow be? 5,000. So is this close to 5,000? Yeah, a little close. Okay, good. So any question about the first part here? Okay, so the next part, which is the present value of the money flow.
Can you go back and show us how you put that into your hatch?
Yeah, I'm having a hard time
getting like 18,000.
Me too.
Okay. Okay. So we're getting lots of 18,000s. Well, maybe I'm wrong. So as an intermediate step, right, 12500, and then you would need to plug in 10. So this would be E to 0.4 minus, you plug in 0, what do you get? 1.
That's probably where I screwed up.
Ah, okay, so I guess you thought if you plug in zero, you get zero. All right, but...
Always.
But,
but you, we always think.
You get one in this case, okay. So two, the present value of the money flow. Good. So what is the formula in terms of big T and F and everything else? Yep, zero to big T. Good. F of T, E to negative RT, DT. So that's the formula. Okay, so then, on this specific exercise, 0 to 10 integral, and then 500 e to 0.04t, and then multiplied by e to negative 0.08t dt. And then, we still have a product. Right. It's not a constant this time. Like last time, it was nice when it was a constant.
But can't we use algebra?
Ah, good, right? Algebra to save the day, right? So this isn't, we want to use the fundamental theorem. Is this one of the antiderivatives we know? No. What's the next step in the Riesz procedure?
Algebra.
Can we algebraically simplify this?
Yes.
Yes, right? Because we have the same base. And when the base is the same and you're multiplying, what do? You add exponents. So this would be 500 and then 0.04t minus 0.08t is what?
0.04. Negative 0.04.
Right, negative 0.04t dt. And then we look at this and say, oh, yes, because we can do this one without by parts. So that's nice, right? So this one can be done without by parts. So this would be 500 over negative 0.04. And then e to negative 0.04t from 0 to 10. And I'll spend the negative. This would be 12500 e to negative 0.04t from 10 to 0. And so now plugging that into the machine. Get 41.299. So does this number pass the reasonableness test?
Yes.
Yes, right? Because this is saying that the total money flow during this time period, if we were to just make a pile of cash, we're just putting everything goes in the pile. $6,147.81. This is saying this is how much you'd be willing to accept right now instead of making a pile of cash. Okay, what is the last thing that we always ask?
A and B, I don't know what to stand for.
The accumulated amount of the money flow. And the formula for it in terms of big T and F and all of that?
E to R big T.
Yes, e to r big T, and then the same integral before. So this would be exponential, and then what was the rate? 8%, 0.08, and then 10 years, and then that number. E to 0.8. Okay, so my calculator is reporting to me 9171.45. So, does this number pass the reasonableness test?
Yes.
Yes, right?
Definitely more than 5,000.
Yeah, it's the bigger. It's the biggest of all three, right? Okay, so now the last thing I want to say is I'm going to ask a question just like this, like probably a number of times. It's going to be doing these three, okay? And, you know, you could make an arithmetic mistake in there somewhere, but in the end, if your numbers aren't in the right order, then you've made more than an arithmetic mistake, okay? That means that you knew that there was some kind of recipe to follow, but you had no idea in the end what was supposed to happen. It would be like if I asked you to make a cake, and you took all the recipe and the ingredients for a cake, and in the end, it looked nothing whatsoever like a cake, and you presented it to me as if it was a cake. No, right.
But it tastes good.
but if it tastes good, okay, good, yeah. Have a nice Tuesday.